simplify that, demystify it a little bit, think about what are the interesting use cases emerging, why is it emerged now? We also have a colleague from San Francisco, Laura, do you want to?
Laura Brodsky, based in San Francisco. I'm an expert in our global payments practice, focusing on all things digital and fintech related.
And we have Kevin.
Hi, Kevin Moll, associate partner in New York. I do a lot of work in digital around payments and more broadly digital commerce.
And we have Rob Whiteman, partner in our Chicago office, coming and stuck in traffic, but he'll be here very shortly. So I'll just get started on the AI 101. Very, very overused term. I want to talk about what do we actually mean by AI? And within that, some other words that we've heard. You know, what do we mean by machine learning? Where does deep learning fit in? How do robotics fit? You know, where do these come in with machine learning? Deep dive a little bit into deep learning. Think about, you know, why now? And also, where is it going? What are the blockages in the industry at the moment? And what is going to be enabled once we overcome these? Just out of curiosity, who in the room is from the kind of finance, commercial side, would consider themselves from that kind of background? And who's from the product side? Wow. And who are other, and what do they do? Okay, well, it's the product guys that will be spoiling my mistakes. So, I mean, there's no doubt that AI is booming. So much activity here. If we look at, you know, funding has gone up 9x since 2012. People are saying it's actually going to triple on last year. Investments in the VC space from about 5 to 15 billion this year across almost every single industry, whether it's healthcare, agriculture, pharma, retail. It really is penetrating almost every single industry vertical you can think of. And that's one of the reasons why people are so excited. It really goes back to this idea of general purpose technologies. If we think about steam power, In the 18th century, you think about electricity at the start of the 20th century. You know, these were really technologies that allowed us to do, almost reimagine every single activity in the economy. And that's why I think people are so excited about AI. But at the same time, people are also a little bit worried about AI. You know, fear sells headlines, sells newspapers, gets clicks, and I think it's massively overblown. Doomsday, terrified. Elon Musk loves to cause a few concerns. But really, I think this causes us to overlook some of the more positive aspects of what AI is really going to do. I think that AI is actually much more likely to help find a cure to a disease that you might have than it is to, you know, destroy mankind. You know, think about Google used DeepMind's algorithm to actually reduce their electricity bill on their data centers by about $400 million. So this is something that's helping reduce fossil fuel consumption. You know, Palantir uses algorithms, AI algorithms, to spot IED, predict the location of IEDs and bombs in Afghanistan to avoid the US Army getting hit. It's being used to work with children to provide enhanced treatments alongside doctors. Being used to help cheapen, speed up, and make more accurate the drug discovery process in the pharma industry. The list goes on. It also gets used to find pictures of cats, which seems to be one of the most popular online applications. So, you know, as I say, the term itself, it's a pretty amorphous. It's used to describe cars, it's used to describe hardware companies. I want to talk about what we really mean about it. It's definitely an issue when Elon, who is helping drive the self-driving car revolution, and Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook has Jan LeCun, who basically invented deep learning. If these two can't agree on what they really mean by AI, then you might wonder what hope the rest of us have. I'm going to try. So I think, when we think about it, research into this area has been going on for a very long time, actually. A lot of the developments, the theoretical developments in the maths behind AI, have been going on since the 50s, 60s, until the first, as we call, AI winter in the late 70s, and the second in the late 80s. I mean, this is where the first kind of fundamental ideas we're arriving about how can we actually mimic the way humans think and improve the processing power of computers, which were also an emerging field. Around the, you know, the 90s, we started to actually be able to go from, you know, what we would traditionally call statistics and inference to use computer science to actually push that forward. What we think about machine learning. Machine learning, and we can go into a bit more detail, is basically human-aided discovery of patterns in data. So, you know, a human will code an algorithm, they'll decide what kind of parameters are interesting, but it will help radically improve the quality, speed of predictions, and process much, much, much more data to come up with much more accurate real-time predictions. Deep learning is the latest incarnation of that branch of AI. So really, we think about the field of artificial intelligence, and you know, as we move towards deep and reinforcement learning, we're getting closer and closer to kind of realizing that goal of true AI. It goes back to the Turing test of Alan Turing's fame. If you can convince three members of the Royal Society that you're a human as opposed to a robot, you've passed the test, and you know that's what he considered true AI. I think it actually goes much beyond tricking people into thinking you're a human or not. It gets much deeper than that. And the way we try and characterize it at the moment is any algorithm or software that is truly self-learning, that can gather insights from data by itself. So it's not just human-driven. It's not just I'm using a better algorithm or a better software package. It's actually by itself defining what do I need to look at in order to solve this problem. So all you really do is provide it with what is the end goal that you're looking for. The model should also be dynamic. As we think about the most advanced applications, really it has to be able to work in real time. The model, you know, the AI algorithm should be able to work with very frequent changes. The world changes very fast. It shouldn't require a human to sit down and reprogram a model or machine in order to be able to get to the right answer. It should be able to do it dynamically. And the implication of this, in many cases, is that solutions are actually moving past the point of human interpretability, which is, of course, its own problems. But that's really what we see in a lot of modern-day AI. And this represents a little bit of the progression over time. It's not a clear-cut line of what is true AI, what is not. You can get into trouble there. We think of it as almost like a spectrum, that the assistive type of intelligence and the much more autonomous. So on the left, traditional statistics, you might run a regression. You think about what are the three or four kind of parameters that are driving an outcome you're trying to predict. So you're trying to predict life expectancy. I'm going to look at, does someone smoke? Are they overweight? Where do they live, etc. And then I'm going to run a regression and find out, okay, these are the things that are associated with this outcome. Machine learning would actually, if you were to take a machine learning approach to that, you might be able to actually take in masses more data. And the computer might actually, the algorithm might actually be able to select its own features from a very, very wide range. It might take 500 different data points across a million individuals, which you could never have done, in Excel. By yourself trying to write a code. Machine learning can take in much, much, much more data and come up with patterns that perhaps you weren't even expecting using things like cluster analysis. Reinforcement and deep learning take a whole different approach. So still taking in masses of data, so what we think of as big data, the explosion that's come with the internet and the Internet of Things, but taking a much more sophisticated approach, which we'll go into in detail, in order to process that data. And then we have these other two components. One is, you might think it was, you've heard of RPA, robotic process automation. This isn't really learning, it's not really intelligent. It's very much manually processed. Human programs, you're trying to determine, okay, here's a step in the process, and you will manually code it to automate that process. It's not really learning. If something changes in that process, a human will have to come in and change that programming again. That's RPA. The more sophisticated and advanced types of of company that are tackling these problems will be able to automate it. So the computer actually will be able to see, okay, the process has changed. I need to now actually update this by itself. You know, a degree of autonomics that is not really prevalent in most of the applications today in RPA. And if you think about, you know, using these technologies of deep and reinforcement learning to automate a real world physical thing, you know, you can think about the self-driving car. It's truly using deep learning to recognize what's around, processing the LiDAR that comes in, and reinforcement learning to be able to constantly improve and be safe. But it's actually applying it to a real world physical scenario. You'll be riding around in very short order. And then finally, we have, you know, what I think of as the interaction layer. So on the left, when we think of the human-coded side, you have your most rudimentary chatbots, which probably, you know, some of us will have the misfortune of using. Really, they're not smart at all. You know that straight away because they're answering your question with a completely wrong answer, and you know it's frustrating because it is hard-coded, it's manual, it's not intelligent, it's not smart. Take it to the you know, furthest extreme, the most advanced that are out there, and where research is going, is that actually you'll have semantic understanding through natural language processing in a conversational agent or in a virtual agent. And that's where, you know, people are infusing AI into this technology. So it will learn from interactions, much as a human does. Whether we're getting there or not, I think we'll tackle in the next talk on conversational commerce. It's a very exciting area. But I just want to kind of create this idea of, it is a spectrum. You know, there are companies that are chatbots that will claim to be AI that really aren't. And often it involves kind of looking into the underlying technology a little bit more. You know, are the algorithms they're using truly learning? Or is it really much more hard-coded? I think it's a really important way of looking at it. You know, one question people might have is, why is AI emerged now? We talked about the explosion of data that's come from digitizing your records, from monitoring the use of your phone, from all of your publicly available social media data, from your clicks, from your searches. That has been organized and made available in a way that has really never existed before. I think I sort of stabbed something like 98% of all of the data in the world was created in the last 2 years, which is phenomenal. In order to be able to do that, in order to be able to process and understand that data, you need, you know, two or three other things. One, which is not up there, but I think goes without saying, is trained human individuals, data scientists, computer scientists, AI researchers, who are able to find patterns in this data, who are able to build hardware, and, you know, write the code and the algorithms that will actually process it. But significantly, it's the hardware. It's, you know, advances in GPU technology, which are able to process data at a much, much higher speed than CPU technology ever was. And it's the development and the, you know, the refinement of deep learning, convolutional neural networks that have been able to actually make sense of particularly sophisticated data sets. And when I think about these data sets, it's actually things like images. You know, an image is a data set. It's a collection of millions of pixels that you have to process, which we've never really been able to process before, but now we can. And the two things democratizing this advance in technology have been, you know, the massive influx of VC funding, allowing startups and people and companies at a much smaller scale to be able to drive it, and cloud computing, which means that you no longer have to own $1 million, you know, NVIDIA DGX-1. You can actually now get it through AWS or Azure or Google Cloud. You can access that kind of tensor programming. This is my McKinsey slide. I'll be brief with this one, but really it shows this is the core of the kind of quote unquote AI technology. This is the backbone of machine learning AI. I think, you know, when I think about AI, I think of it much as, say, you know, 10, 15 years ago, there were a few internet retailers, and they were very distinct from physical. Now, pretty much every company is an internet company. You know, every retailer sells online, almost every retailer. In my mind, in 10 years' time, you know, almost every company will be an AI-driven company. They will use, almost without thinking, machine learning algorithms, deep learning algorithms, both in their operations and in their products. I think it just goes without saying. But for today, these are the companies that are driving the advances in what we can actually do with these algorithms. So most important, really, has been the data. Without data, you can't train your algorithms, you can't learn. They're not accurate. It's really, really very important to get the data. And when we think about who are going to be the biggest players in the field of AI itself, it's the companies that are capturing all the data. So if we look at Facebook, if we look at Google, they've managed to capture a huge share of all the data on you, on your behavior, on how you think, what you're clicking on. I mean, it's absolutely incredible. If you look at some of the acquisitions people like IBM are making, it's into players who have data. It's the weather company, because they know that without data, it's the oil, it's the electricity that's going to drive this whole revolution. I think that's an area that's not really emphasized enough in the conversation about AI. Really is one of the most important aspects. We have the people, and then we have the tools, the hardware, and then the industry applications, which we'll talk about some more interesting ones. So deep learning, I think it's probably the latest wave the most exciting, the most hyped. I sometimes think with deep learning, we're really at the peak of the hype cycle. But in other ways, really at the very, very beginning of the journey that we're going to go on in terms of the impact and the commercial impact of this technology. So the analogy and the kind of the reason that we think we are often called neural networks is it mimics the structure and the processing kind of logic of the human brain. So in the human brain, you have neurons which connect to each other through axons. You have millions and millions and millions of these. When you see an elephant for the first time, you will have a very specific path of these neurons that will light up. Electrical flows will occur, and they will go through one axon versus another axon. And that specific pattern will represent, in your mind, the memory of the image of an elephant. That's how memory works. If we look at the traditional neural network, it works in a similar way. Instead of electrical signals, you have weights. So instead of the strength of the electrical signal, and the strongest electrical signal will mark what is the memory, you will have weights. So depending on the output that you're trying to determine, it will be the weight of the input that the algorithm that the model applies that will determine how the model is constructed. This allows it to process much more data about much more people. So if you think about, I had a good example on insurance. If you think about what you're trying to optimize for, so say it's an underwriting decision. You might have a much lower weight. It's an underwriting decision you're trying to minimize risk. You might have a much lower rate if you have a 25-year-old male driver or 22-year-old male driver in a big city. You may, on the other hand, you have an algorithm you're trying to sell, used sports cars. You may find that you want to put a higher weight on 22-year-olds in big cities. Probably actually over 50s in big cities, but it will really depend on what the outcome you're trying to achieve is. And the layer that is doing the processing we call the hidden layer. Now, the more complex a task you're trying to achieve, so for instance, recognizing an image, you actually need much more of these hidden layers because there's a much greater degree of complexity in processing that image. I've got a great way of looking at it here. When you're trying to recognize an image which has millions of pixels, it's actually incredibly sophisticated. What a deep learning algorithm will do is each of those hidden layers are trying to understand one small component of that image. So one layer may be trying to understand a given set of pixels. Another layer may be clustering of different sets of pixels. Another layer may be clustering those layers into, say, a feature. In this case, it might be an eye or a corner of a mouth. And those layers of abstraction will keep going up until the whole image is being processed. Not only will you see that it's that it's a mouth and an eye, you'll see that it's a very specific female mouth of a very specific person with something in the background. You know, this has been the big breakthrough of AI. Deep learning has allowed us to do things that, you know, really people didn't think would be possible ever. People didn't even imagine it would be possible. It's incredibly exciting. It goes back to 2012, the ImageNet competition. There's an annual competition. You have to categorize and recognize with a machine. I think it's 1 million images in the database in 1,000 categories. So it could be, here's a zucchini on a plate with, you know, a dog sitting in the background. Or it could be, here's a factory with a hook. So 1,000 categories. Incredibly difficult challenge. Know, to process these images. You couldn't do it manually with a million images. In 2010, this was run, and I believe, you know, the error rate was around 30%+. So the machine got it right kind of 2/3 of the time. In 2012, they used deep learning for the first time, and the error rate went down to 16%. Last year, Google entered the competition, won. The error rate was 6.7%. And by the way, the human error rate is 5%. So very soon, this is going to be more accurate than a human in detecting images. And you can take this to video. You can take it to audio. And the applications are just fascinating. I'd love to run through some of them. When we think about healthcare, I think it was Jeff Hinton at Google who said, if you're in medical school today, don't go into radiology. We have enough radiologists. It's going to be computers from this point on. One of the really fascinating examples I've seen, so it's used for, you know, image classification can actually now recognize lung cancer far more accurately than a human. It can recognize, you know, radiologists look at an x-ray, they'll be trying to understand, is this a cancerous nodule or is this just something, a smudge on the x-ray? An algorithm can now do that far more effectively than a human, which is pretty astounding. What's really astounding is that when Kaggle, which is the data science competition, ran this competition to see who could create the most accurate algorithm for detecting nodules, cancerous nodules on an x-ray, the winner was using deep learning, and they couldn't actually figure out how it was working. So it was so accurate. So they actually blocked out some of the nodules to see what it was zooming in on. And they actually found it was still really accurate. And it turns out that there was an imperceptible gradation in the color around the nodule, which no doctor could ever see. It was really so, so imperceptible that the algorithm was picking it up and actually caused doctors to go back and reassess what they knew about lung cancer, which is just fascinating, the way that that's driving progress in the field. In healthcare, it's also being used to help speed up the process of drug discovery, as I mentioned. Companies like Benevolent AI, you know, it's incredibly expensive and time-consuming, often quite wasteful to get to one successful drug trial. And they're actually able to process, and you'll have millions of combinations of molecules that will actually go into creating a new pharmaceutical. What they are able to do now, using this type of technology, is filter down much, much, much more quickly what's going to be the most accurate and most effective set of molecules, and then just trial those. It's an unbelievable kind of step change in the efficiency of medical research.
Can we ask questions?
Sure, yeah, please.
Back to that, so we did the, because it's still hard to get your arms wrapped around whether or not it's deep learning, how it's learning, et cetera. So the system that won, did it know to, you were talking about the, around the lung cancer,
yeah.
Or whatever. Did it know that that was tied to the cancer? Did somebody input that in?
No.
I mean, how did it come about that?
Yeah, it's a really good question. It's a really good question. So one of the interesting aspects of how these work is something called backpropagation. So what they will have a training set which has the traits. So they'll have a data set, let's say 100 images. 50 of them they'll put into the first kind of run. And in each image, it will say, this is cancerous, this is not cancerous. So let's say there are 25 cancerous images and not. And the computer is given these and the computer gets to look at each and say, okay, that is, that isn't. And so that's the kind of output. You work backwards. So the computer can see what is the correct answer, what is the incorrect answer. And then it works backwards. And it will define the weights on each layer that says whether it's true or not. So the computer basically analyzed each image to such a degree of specificity on a pixel by pixel level that it could identify, it could determine by looking at those two data sets what is and what is not. And that way, when you take the second half of the data set, it then applies it to that data set as well. That's the test.
So you work from backwards,
exactly.
This way, and then forward,
exactly.
To predict.
We'll speak more to that when we're on the panel, but basically there's three flavors of workloads, and candidly, there's many flavors of compute. It's not just a CPU or GPU or an FPGA or ASIC or any of that. So that's also not, that's a misnomer. And the algorithms are also a misnomer. What it basically falls into are three kinds of workloads. One is known as scoring, the second is known as inference, and the third is known as training. The training is where you actually teach the algorithm what you're trying to recognize, and that's the most labor intensive, and that's the most compute intensive, and that's where you're actually teaching the algorithm the formula what to recognize. If it's an image, if it's a piece of language, if it's a mathematical pattern, whatever you can get into. Second piece of it is how you recognize that, and that's a recursive layer. You fold in the layers, which is what he's demonstrating up there. And then the third is scoring, so you start weighting against one another. Those are the three workloads. We can talk more about it, I don't want to interrupt.
No, that's very helpful.
Does that help?
Yes.
Yeah. So we can go into further details.
One clarification, but that is based on data that's already been inputted. So
exactly.
It's not the same as a production workload. This is when you're building a non-production system, when you're prototyping, and it's, again, I want to clarify, this is not based on human intelligence. These are super specialized non-human systems. So these are not for human applications. These are machine-to-machine applications for machine deployments.
Correct,
so
but it's still based on data that the machine has been fed. It's not.
Correct.
Exactly.
So anything outside of data.
It's not for production environments per se. First, you have to build this environment, and we'll talk more about this.
Yeah, so what
yeah.
I described was the training process. For production, it would be, I'd take that algorithm, and I'd apply it to looking at someone off the street, and to look at an X-ray of their lungs. That would be production, as you said. You don't know the right answer in that case. You'd have to find out. But for the training set, they are all annotated. And it's actually one of the problems with deep learning is you need very, very large data sets which are already pre-annotated. So what I described with ImageNet, that million images, a human has gone through each single one of those and said exactly what it is in order to be able to match. So that's one of the challenges.
Number of images put in or number of layers, because I think I saw the number of 100 plus.
Yeah, it's even 1,000 now.
Right, okay, so thinking about the combination, which one do you assign more weight?
Why
don't we just go through the, if you want to do the panel, we can go through all the production systems.
Sure, yeah.
Sorry, this is too
difficult. No, it's okay, yeah.
Because it's curious, like I'm always interested in like what's the optimal number? Like you said, it's 1,000 now, is there a number that it's a good number to work with?
It's a very good technical question. I think we have an engineer who's going to be able to give a very good technical answer. The simple kind of answer that I would give is, depends on the sophistication and the level of detail in the data that you're trying to process and the answer you're getting to, but I imagine we'll have a much more detailed answer coming up. So that's the healthcare side. On insurance, has anyone here come across Lemonade? Not one person, wow, two people. So Lemonade is fantastic. I'm not paid to endorse them, but it's a mobile bank, it's a mobile insurance company. I think it's, from what I've seen, it's smaller insurance firms, renter's insurance or I damaged my coat. What's kind of revolutionary about Lemonade is they pay your claim within seconds. This claim was the fastest payment they've done was for a coat over Christmas, and it was in 2.3 seconds or something like that, because everything is automated. So the underwriting process when you sign up is automated to determine your rate. The fraud detection process is automated. The assessment is automated as well when it comes to claims. And each stage of that is automated through a machine learning approach to understanding your risk profile, to understanding how likely you are to have committed fraud in submitting that claim. It's really changing the insurance industry. One of the challenges that has existed in the past and that still exists is explainability of an algorithm. So when it comes to deep learning, it's very hard for a human to say, oh, this underwriting algorithm scored this consumer a high risk because X. You can't really look at it, it's too complicated. And for regulatory bodies in the US government, they're very nervous about that because you could inadvertently be discriminating against people on basis of gender or race, things that you are by law and shouldn't discriminate on. So that's one of the big challenges that this technology is facing. And I don't actually know how Lemonade does it, but it's one example of an attacker into what has been a state industry. Another example is, I can't remember which insurance company is now, that allows you to just take a photo of your car damage, submit it to the insurer, and they don't need to come and visit your car, they don't need to come check it out, they don't need a mechanic to deliver an assessment. They will just look at that image and they can actually automatically process it and determine how much damage has occurred that they should pay out, again, using that kind of image classification. So, every industry, even agriculture, this is an amazing company called Blue River Technologies. They have this unit they'll put on the back of a tractor. I think they're farming lettuces here. And what they do is use image recognition on this unit as they're going past, and it can spot what is a weed and what is the plant. And they will only squirt fertilizer on the plant, not on the weed. So that reduces the cost and the amount of fertilizer you have to use by a significant order of magnitude. And then they can do likewise for the pesticide. It's safer, it's better for the environment, and it improves yields of cabbages, I believe, by something like 17% on each acre. Incredibly, intuitive, just a very simple but amazing application of image recognition. And this is one of the earliest ones in agriculture that I've seen. I think we're going to see so many like that coming from every single industry. You've just improved efficiency, you've made it better for the environment, it's more commercially sustainable. I think it's really amazing. And finally, retail. The Amazon Go store, still in beta, I believe, if anyone's from Seattle. It's just for Amazon employees at the moment. And they haven't broken down the very specifics of how it works, but you check in with your phone, and they have cameras. They will actually use image recognition to see what product you've taken off the shelf and automatically put it onto your bill. And then you can just walk out without paying or without talking to anyone, no queues, no checkout. Even physical retail now is being changed with AI, with deep learning, with image recognition technologies. I'm sure there are going to be so many others. There's a company called The Take that actually, when you're watching a movie or a TV show, they can actually spot what is the dress, what is that jacket, what is that cool pair of shoes you just saw, and it can tell you can kind of activate it on your computer. And it will tell you, oh, those are from Target, or those are and it will give you a link then to actually go and buy it. So it's infiltrating almost every aspect of retail. We talked a little bit about what are the challenges and where deep learning is going to go. We talked about the explainability problem. One is also this data problem. You need so much labeled, annotated, accurate, and trained data to be able to train the algorithms. The dream is of one-shot learning. If I show a child that picture of the elephant, they don't need 300 pictures of elephants to know when they see an elephant in the wild. One elephant is probably enough. So the dream is to be able to, and a lot of research is going into being able to use one or two pieces of data to inform an algorithm. I think we also have just general improvements in performance, in speed, in accuracy, and it's happening. These developments are being made every day. The funding that's going in, the research that's happening, we're seeing actually tremendous advances in the field. And I'm sure some of our panelists will be able to talk in more technical detail about why and how those are happening. Is it going to be 2025? Is it going to be 2050 before we have general AI? I think we all have some copies of our reports. On the table. We have some more online as well from our NGI division. And I'm happy to, I'll be around, I'm happy to talk further, ask, answer any questions. I think it's a really fascinating area. I love talking about it. Great. Any other questions?
Yeah, that original, so it's still hard to think of what's fluff versus, I'm a consultant, so I'll pick on a consultant. What's consulting spin and VC money spin versus what's actually AI?
Yeah.
So in your view, I mean, you go back, long-term, yes, depending upon your definition, I see it much bigger. But what's, in your view, what's fluff versus reality? You know, how much is the real deal?
Yeah.
Because everyone talks about it, and the concern I have, I guess, is always when VC money drives it, then it sounds speculative instead of what's really the science behind it.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's one of the things I didn't see here is how much, and maybe Meg or somebody else will go through this, you know, in the advances, because it's really AI gets around the whole science of it, not the money of it. I know the money people follow, but it seems to me like some of it is just being driven by anybody saying, hey, I've got an AI algorithm.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely right. We're completely at the peak of the hype cycle. You know, if you put an AI on your business plan, you're gonna be able to raise twice as much money as before. So there's definitely that component of it that's driving you know, inflated claims and this kind of hype, this, in many cases, unwarranted hype. And the degree to which people are already using it, you know, truly using what we describe as like fundamentally self-learning dynamic type of algorithm, I think is really quite low. We're still looking at the emerging kind of exploratory use cases, you know, in each industry. I showed in agriculture, you know, we still have a human driving the tractor. There's still people involved in every stage of the process. I think that the penetration rate of these technologies is just is very low. So we're definitely at the top of the hype cycle. We're definitely at the very start, really, of the adoption of these technologies. In terms of what's fluff, you know, I haven't scanned like the crunch base of the 700 companies that got funded last year to see what is truly AI. I imagine, you know, it's actually quite small. The number of people that are, you know, truly able to research and develop in this field is so small. That's why DeepMind got bought at a $5 million per employee multiple. I think the same happened with Element that got funded not long ago, because, you know, there's so few of these scientists that can actually do it. The technology, I think, the advances are real, but the degree to which these have been truly commercialized and productized, we're at the very start of the process, I think.
So from I'm with Intel, and we're not consultants, we build things. so we tend to take a very different look at what the AI industry looks like. For me, I've been a data scientist for 16 years. When I was an undergrad and grad, I started building computational models for genetic weighting and genetic predictive models for a long time. I came out of grad school during the winter of AI. So this is all I've done my entire career. I've never seen a hype cycle like this. That's why I'm framing it up. It is a very real and legitimate hype cycle. But the hype part around AI versus the actual technology behind it, let's unpack that a little bit, and let's talk through that a little bit. So that there's four elements of the non-hype part that we should talk through around what's called a hype cycle of AI. There's something known as machine learning. There's something known as deep learning. There's something known as advanced analytics. There's also the vast repository of data, that's machine-to-machine data, content-to-content data, cloud-based data, consumer data, system-to-system data. We can talk a lot more about data during, I'll be giving a keynote on Wednesday, and I'll be speaking more about this, but there'll be a vast amount of data coming. Data, for instance, one car in the course of a day will generate 4 terabytes of data. Of that, less than 0.0001% is relevant to a human being. Just think about that for a little bit. Okay, that's most of that is machine relating to itself. So okay, that's machine, deep, advanced analytics. Right? but what is what I call consumer analytics, the top layer at which the system is consuming it, or the human is consuming it, or the emoji is consuming it, or the web interface is consuming it. And then the back end, which is the systems integration part of it. So what Martin talked through was just a really fantastic survey and an overview at a topical level. In this past year, Intel, we, and as have many, many other companies, that have been acquired at AI companies. There is no such thing as an AI company. There are companies in deep learning, there are companies in machine learning, there are companies in advanced analytics, there are companies in content development. All of these feed into AI systems that are being built, which is why it's called AI. Some people call it artificial intelligence, others call it augmented intelligence. And intelligence isn't what we humans think of as intelligence, the way machines, I'm sorry, the way animals or humans do intelligence. There's intelligence the way a system that can accelerate and autonomously make decisions for itself. Most of these systems that are being built are far superior than any animal or human at doing one sensory workload optimized 10, 1500 x better than any natural system can. That's why we're automating it, so they can rationalize something that no natural system can, to help simplify that complexity, right? Remember that one part with 4 terabytes of data? 99.999% of that is the white line on the road going by for hours on end, and the gravel under it.
Thank you.
Sorry, I didn't mean to sidetrack, but hopefully that gives some context.
And I think the track that, you know, companies and consultants fall into is, it's a sexy phrase that gets people interested. You say AI, and people are interested. If I say, you know, convolutional neural network, I think some people would not come in and see this topic. So
that's absolutely
yeah,
true. Yeah.
So there's a little track, but no, absolutely right. I'm looking forward to the panel as well. So I think Laura's going to talk about